Hey there, I'm Lee Ullman here with some big news from the National Young Farmers Coalition. We're partnering with Heritage Radio Network on a special season of The Farm Report. It's all about what's happening with the Farm Bill and how it impacts farmers and eaters.
I am growing diversified vegetables on land that's been in our family for 150 years.
And so with the pandemic, gentrification, property values going up, we had to sell the land and we lost it.
Join us as we uncover the untold stories behind this massive piece of legislation that shapes how we grow our food, what we eat, and so much more.
The problems we have had, those are things that come from earlier Farm Bill and USDA policy, right? Like Earl Butts, get big or get out.
You know, it's my responsibility to know not only what I'm eating, but then like how that all came to be and realize like, wow, like this piece of legislation, all this money, like it's technically something that I support as a taxpayer.
While Congress debates the next Farm Bill, this is not just an invitation to listen. It's a call to action. Be part of the conversation. Subscribe to the Farm Report on Heritage Radio Network, wherever you listen to podcasts.
Today's program was brought to you by 100 Bogart Street, the brand new co-working space in Bushwick, Brooklyn. Learn more at 100bogart.com.
You're listening to Heritage Radio Network. We're a member-supported food radio network broadcasting over 35 weekly shows live from Bushwick, Brooklyn. Join our hosts as they lead you through the world of craft brewing, behind the scenes of the restaurant industry, inside the battle over school food, and beyond. Find us at heritageradionetwork.org.
Hello and welcome to Snacky Tunes. I am one half your host, Greg Bresnitz. On today's episode, we have Chef Greg Backstrom of Olmsted that talks about the Platonic ideals of brunch and how to repurpose his famous carrot dish into a very snacky brunch version. Jameson Fink shows us how to navigate wine lists and restaurants. Hint, go to the other side. And finally, Desert Sharks talks about meeting each other on the now recently defunct Craigslist ads and how to be the house band in Gotham. Sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of Snacky Tunes.
We talk about food. We talk about music with musical dudes. Finger on the pulse, Snacky Tunes.
today is going to rip. That was just Desert Sharks, who will be live in studio here on Snacky Tunes. I am one half your host, Greg Bresnitz. Thanks everyone who came out to Snacky Tunes Live in Los Angeles a couple weeks ago. Stay tuned. We will be announcing our second one that will be coming up end of July out in Los Angeles. But I am joined now by Chef Greg Backstrom. Chef,
hello.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you.
Chef owner, founder, proprietor, Olmsted.
Chef owner.
Chef owner.
Yeah.
One of the things that's really interesting about Olmsted is you opened it with a farmer.
Yeah.
Most people will, you know, open it with farms they work with, but you lead that you opened it with Ian. What went into that decision, and how do you think that changed the focus of the restaurant from the beginning?
Well, I mean, when I was looking for my restaurant space, for a restaurant space, after years of trying to narrow it down, and I never really could figure out what the food was going to look like or what the feeling was going to be like at the restaurant. But I did know that I wanted like a 10-seat bar, like a small enough dining room that I could still kind of control service, but still be a profitable restaurant, and just some type of outside space. But I didn't want it to just be more tables outside. I wanted it to be different. I wanted it to be, like I grew up on a farm that had a garden, and I wanted to have a little bit of that in the restaurant, and then the guests be able to experience it. And Ian is a really good friend of mine, so it was just sort of a no-brainer. We used to talk about it all the time. How do we, have something like that can impact the restaurant? Whether it was food cost or whether it was just the novelty thing and it was just a pretty aesthetic. But I knew that I always wanted some type of, gardening element.
And where do you felt that, where were you surprised on how it affected? Obviously food costs is because you're going to the source, but like where were other surprises or delights that you kind of found that you think had you opened a restaurant without a farmer as your partner, you might not have had?
I mean, it's really just, it's an attraction. So it's another reason why guests come. Like we really try, at Olmsted, it's not like this is what it is, take it or leave it. If you don't get us, you're not going to get it. We want to be as approachable and as charming and as, affordable as we can make it. And so that's just what the garden is. We are able to grow the sunflower sprouts for the carrot dish that we do, and we're only starting our third year, so we still keep planting different things in different parts of the garden because there's shade and whatnot. But we did expand again last year. We expanded the garden. We took over the lot next door, but we just did that again. So now this year, we're still working on it because it just happened this past week. But we will now have three lots of garden space for the one restaurant.
Has there been things that Ian has been dying to grow, but just based on what you were serving, he was like, if you get me more space, I want to grow this, but understood that there was a hierarchy of what could be grown?
In the beginning, it was, it's not really like that. It's not like a hierarchy. In fact, Ian has since moved on to sort of like a very similar situation at Blue Hill Storm Barns, where there's this benefactor that has this large property, and he's growing just like a ton of stuff on this property. So he's not as round as much, but we still have a farmer and a lot of the staff that works at the restaurant has a part of them that is into agriculture. Like for example, our general manager, she spends half of her time being general manager, but the other half trying to find new ways to make us more sustainable. So like right now we're looking into having a cistern put in so that we can capture rainwater. So rainwater becomes our irrigation system for the garden. Stuff like that. Like it's not a fully functioning farm. We tried to make it so that way it is somewhat representative of like a small closed system. So we have the birds and we have some quail that lay eggs and we have some fish and we clean the pot. They're a little, it's in a clawfoot tub. So when we drain that tub every month, we spray that again over the garden. You know, we have these flies that produce larvae that becomes the fish feed. So we like attempt it. It's in no way like a perfect example, but that part is really for us. And then if the guests have an interest in that, there's plenty of story there. It's the same thing with the plates. It's the same thing with the ingredients that we use, the wine that we serve, the cocktails. It's for us, there's a ton of purpose behind every little thing, even if it seems like crab rangoon stuffed in a Chinese to-go box or egg rolls in a little French fry box that we have custom made. Like, we want it to be at face value just this cute, tasty thing, and then we, behind the scenes, we make the bacon that only 7 grams of bacon is going into each little thing, each little egg roll, but we steam off scrambled eggs, and then we make ricotta to fold into the scrambled eggs that we're buying from local milk. So, like, there's a lot that's going into those silly little crab rangoon or the egg rolls or really any dish. But that's not what we're trying to get the guests to.
And as far as, you know, you opened a farm in the city.
Yeah.
Which, you know, people, it's very easy to, people say, it's like, oh, we don't have the space, we don't have the ability to do it. What were some of the early lessons or kind of things that you would give advice to other people to encourage them, you know, these are speed bumps, not walls, for opening up an urban farm?
If you can afford it, irrigate it, because it takes, you know, it's big enough and it takes an hour and a half just for someone to water it when it's really hot and it needs to be watered every day. And that's time, and time that could be spent on something else. So that's something that we are just doing this year. And then we kept buying starts, like, you know, eight-week-old plants that we would then plant, so that way we can have things constantly growing. But that's expensive to do that. So now we have a greenhouse. It's like a 10-foot, you know, 10 by 6-foot greenhouse. But it's enough to grow our own starts to put in the living wall that we have in the restaurant or on the garden. And it helps us turn our crops a lot faster.
When you read about them, especially, you know, like Chef Dan Barber, you know, they talk about, you know, farmers coming and showing up and saying, you know, try this, try that, or chefs even saying, hey, can you grow this for me? I want to do this. Was there anything that Ian or your new farmer kind of comes to you and says, hey, this is kind of cool, have you thought about incorporating this into the menu?
Yeah, like, so down the street, we also have this, another neighbor has given us like a 2,000 square foot plot on their roof, basically. And so just trying to figure out things like, you know, things that turn over in 42 days, so that way we can actually have enough of it. Because we're still a small restaurant, so even though we're thankfully very busy, we're only talking about doing 100 people a night. Like, right. That is the most that we can only do, 125 people. Like, we're just, that is that capacity. So if we're talking about a salad and we're only going to sell 20 a night and there's only 7 days a week, like, that's something that the farmer can then be like, look, I can bring you 20 heads of romaine if that's something that you can do. I can keep up with that. So that's, again, like, with, you know, when you open up the restaurant, as much as I wanted it to be hyper sustainable from day one and I wanted to be growing everything, all these heirloom things that were super fascinating and interesting, it's just not how it works. I'm trying to make sure the menu is printed right. Now that we're like, we have a really great staff, a lot of the staff has been there for well over a year, so they really start to take ownership of it. And now we can kind of divert attention. Now there's watercress growing in the living wall that's for our duck dish, for our entree. Like, that's super, super cool.
That's so cool.
Right.
What's the time? Can the guests go pick the ingredient and then be like, yes, I want that, put in my dish?
Well, what we want to do this year is we have a lot of berries that grow in the back in the second garden, a lot of strawberries and then currants and a little bit of blueberries and some blackberries. And so we want that to become like a dessert option. Like, if you order soft serve or if you order ice cream, we don't want it. Soft serve was too big of a thing last year, so we're not going to do it this year. And so we want to do something else. I still want it to be ice cream, but we want it to be like, you know, guests go and pick out the fruit for their ice cream, their sundae or something like that, you know?
One of the other key relationships was the relationship between your dad, who helped build the restaurant. We had Ariel from Ari Champagne Parlor, whose father also helped her build it. You mentioned you're from Chicago, and the restaurant is built from an old barn.
Yeah. My dad is here. He just landed, and he's surveying because we're going to open up another restaurant this year, and we want to expand the garden. So he literally just flew in so that way he can kind of get an idea of what we're going to do next.
What's his background?
He's a carpenter. I mean, he basically, like, 30 years ago, he bought this old farmhouse. There's 5 acres of land. One of the acres is a pond. This is where I grew up with my brother and my sister. And just like a couple of years ago, the barn got hit by a tornado. So he's always trying to, he's a pretty sentimental guy. So he's always trying to, like, he built parts of my sister's house and incorporated some of the barn wood. And so it was like a no-brainer when I got the keys to the restaurant that I flew out and that we loaded up his van with all of his tools and threw some barn wood in there and we just drove it. And we were like, hopefully it's enough to do something. And then it ended up being enough to frame out the counter. Like, even with the counter, like, we have this little chef's counter thing. But really, it's not because we wanted some elite seats or anything. We just needed two more seats so that way the restaurant could have two more, more covers. And it was either against a wall and it would be kind of uncomfortable or just be okay with them staring right into the kitchen.
And like any relationship working with family, it comes with its pluses and minuses. Did your dad have a certain vision where you aligned on how it would look? He's like, my wood, my tools, my way.
There is a little bit of that. But when you have a very small budget, you kind of just go with that. Like he just knew better, you know, how am I going to, I'd rather have the light switch over here. And he just rolled his eyes. Like, that's not going to happen. You know, I'm not going to spend three more days moving the electrical around because, you know, whatever, but we just wouldn't have like, I find the restaurant charming and I really do attribute that to just my dad being there. Like, we would problem solve in real time. Like, we didn't have an architect or a designer come and say, this is what you should do. We took over a restaurant that failed and we had no money. And so, for example, with the garden, we're sitting out in the garden and we're like, okay, well, let's just grow stuff out here and guests can wander around like it's a little park. And then we thought that was a little pretentious. So then we were like, okay, so if a guest is sitting outside for 15 minutes, you know, are they going to sit down on the bench or sit down on the gravel? Okay, so then that means we really need seats. So then there's every time, okay, so now that we have seats, I think, are they going to hold their glass or are they going to want to put it somewhere? So then he just built retrofitted tables that clipped into the garden. And because we were able to do that from the kitchen counter needing two more seats to the garden beds and the tables, he just was able to build the solutions to every problem that kept arising. And that's Olmsted. And the bar, all of it.
A lot of people we have on the show that are family are siblings that we work with. Darren, our twins. Not so many generational. We had Jacob's Pickle on here, Ariel as well. Do you feel that you shared a similar aesthetic design context because he was your father and he taught it to you? And like you were reading from the same book because he bought the books?
Yeah, totally. I mean, we're building another restaurant, but we also are... we took over another space, and that's just going to be a little PDR room. Like, our biggest table is five people, and it's really not that comfortable for five people. So we're trying to fix that. And I really want it to be where my dad flexes. Like I want him to put a lot of crown molding and wainscoting and wallpaper and chandelier. Like, I want it to be he's good at woodwork. And so it'll probably end up looking a little bit like the house I grew up in. But I'm...
That's amazing.
Maybe it's a little too Midwestern. Hopefully that will be ironic in Brooklyn or something. But I'm looking forward to seeing how that turns out.
Is there one piece of advice you can give when you are going up against your dad and, you know, it's your restaurant, but he's building. Is there one piece of advice you give people on how to navigate it and still, you know, maintain a good relationship but get what you want?
Just say yes. I wasn't going to... He was working 12-hour days, sleeping on my couch because he's, you know, stubborn and wouldn't take my bed, and just, you know, waking up at 6, starting working, you know, we would stop around 8 o'clock at night, eat, go to bed, and we flipped the restaurant in 99 days, exactly 99 days. Like, that doesn't happen.
That's unreal.
Yeah.
We're going to take a quick musical break, going to play a song from the archives, and then we're going to come back and talk about Brunch.
Cool. Yeah, definitely.
Here we are with the song from the archives on Snacky Tunes podcast.
place where no one is right. Revolution is running from an unfortunate life. But everybody seems good. Everybody seems high. Revolution is running.
So you just came from brunch service.
I just shot over here, yeah.
You just shot over here from brunch. This just started a couple weeks ago.
Last week.
What was it that held you off from starting brunch service when it's an obvious, you know, you're in Brooklyn, it's an not easy revenue stream, but it's a very strong additional revenue stream. What held you back?
Because if I were going to do it, I wanted it to be like comparable to dinner service. Like I would like to open up a breakfast place, full disclosure, called Greg's Over Easy someday.
Hold on.
Yeah.
Just one more time. One more time.
Greg's Over Easy.
Oh my gosh.
So like
I'm stealing that from when I make breakfast for my girlfriend. I don't know where this came from. Greg's Over Easy. Okay.
Yeah, somebody spit it out like 10 years ago, and it's always stuck with me. And I really like cooking that type. Like, if I cook for myself, it's regardless of the time of the day, it's like definitely breakfast focused.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just didn't want it to be, Eggs Benedict and French toast and whatever. I wanted to be able to like actually give it time. It took a long time to put the menu together. Like, I think, and hopefully it is perceived that it's very thoughtful. There's sweet stuff. There's savory stuff. There's still things that have bacon, egg, and cheese in it. But there's playfulness. Like, it's not like getting a lesser version of the dinner menu is what I wanted it to, be.
You know, you talk about it like being almost recognizable, but not being what you would regularly see. What are some of the intangibles of brunch?
Well, like we have like these egg rolls. We're like steaming off. We're making like almost like a custard, and then folding in ricotta that we make. Then we're making bacon that takes us a week, and then we source this like mix of like all these upstate. Vermont. It's in Vermont. It's like this mix of a cooperative shredded cheddar cheese. And so there's all this thought going into these things. We're selling, 45 orders of these things a day, and there's four pieces in each one. So this guy, it takes us 3 or 4 hours to make these silly little things. We put them in a French fry box that we had a friend of mine help me design that has like an egg, skateboarding on a,
it's very cute.
A wheel of cheese kind of thing, and he's waving a crispy piece of bacon. And we make ketchup from green tomatoes, and we put it into our own. We bought room service ketchup bottles and soaked them and emptied them out. We obviously ate the ketchup for staff meal, but, then we put our own label on it and all this stuff. And so, like I was saying earlier, hopefully it's just cute and tasty and fried, but it's we get to put the type of skill into the food that we want to do as cooks. Where we're making the bacon and we're putting all this labor into it, and there's technique behind it, but they're Instagrammable and they're tasty and they're and they're just fried and they have bacon, egg, and cheese. Like, they have what you want if you want breakfast. So like, we're not trying to fight the things that people want. So there is cinnamon buns, but they're not cinnamon buns. I have some Austrian background. And so I happened to know a really talented Austrian pastry chef. And so we morphed apple strudel into a cinnamon bun. And, it's because it's one of the only things that my dad would make as a pastry. Like, he only makes two things, apple strudel and chicken soup.
My dad only makes like liver and beans.
Oh, yeah.
So it's like and he does it very well, but those are very specific dad things.
Yeah.
It's like, how many times did you eat this growing up? Yeah. How many times did you make it for dates? Yeah, like, it's like, I've got my dinner item and then I've got my dessert item and
right.
That's all I ever needed.
Right, totally. And so, I just like duck. And who doesn't like duck? And I think we make a nice duck sausage. So we're doing like our sweet and savory one, like pancakes and eggs and stuff is... it's scrambled eggs with duck sausage, and then we make to order like a maple flatbread. So that's like sort of like your pancake. There's the egg, there's the sausage. It's sweet, it's salty, it's got some Fresno chilies in it, so it's like a little spicy. We're intentionally, there's gravlax, but instead of bagels, we make crackers that we season with an everything bagel mix that we make. And then we even took lye that normally you spray on pretzels, so that way we would get the sheen on the bagel cracker. And then instead of cream cheese, because I don't know how to make cream cheese, but I know how to make ricotta. I made ricotta and hung it for a little while so it would be thick like cream cheese, and then I folded scallions in it, so then I have scallion ricotta with bagel crackers and gravlax that we make. And so, like, if you're just in the mood for bagels and lox, like, you'll get that fix. We're making our own yogurt and we're making our own granola. Like, everything that you expect, we have it. That's like what we want. We don't want it to be like, here is your,
it's like the fancy something, or
your esoteric waffle or something with a weird, grain or something like that.
Right. It's like the Platonic ideals of brunch, and then like run through the Olmsted lens.
Yeah. Exactly. And so like, I'm really excited because we're gonna make the garden a little bit bigger. There's gonna be a little bit more seating out there, and so like, I really can't wait to see what that looks like when it's on a Friday, Saturday, Sunday during the summer. during the day, just like people out there having mimosas and walking around the garden.
It's like jazz. Like you took a standard and you riffed on it and and made
exactly.
it your own.
Yeah.
When you were ideating and when you and your team were ideating, what were some of the kind of criteria or standard you held them to get it to your level of brunch? Or what were some recipes that like were kind of there but didn't quite make it because it didn't feel like an Olmsted brunch item?
The yogurt, like trying to get the texture of, like, you know, it's not like the most popular one, but I still think it should be available. Like someone that doesn't want all this other stuff, someone that's maybe been a couple of like we're gonna get a lot of neighbors. Like we've already had people. We've only been open for 2 weeks, and we've already had people come back. So the menu is a little bit long for the type of restaurant that we have. It's like 13, 14 items for brunch. The yogurt, like, you know, do we want it to be kind of like thick Greek yogurt? Do we want it to be a little bit softer? I liked it being a little bit runnier. That took a lot. The Gravlax, like the smoke and the cure and like sourcing a sustainable fish that, you know, this is not salmon season. So it took us a while to find a salmon that we can use. The burger, like we make our own breakfast sausage and then we take, New York State grass fed beef and we like figuring out that ratio of how much beef and sausage, how beefy should it be for brunch or should it be more breakfasty? I mean, all of it took like a month of back and forth.
I always feel that people sleep on the yogurt at Tua Familia. They had this aerated yogurt dish that I went and just kind of looked off a few times. Then someone's like, you have to try it. And I had it. And by far,
yeah.
Fresh berries, aerated yogurt. And you're just, you know, it's sometimes the most simple things. How long did it take you to get the yogurt to where you wanted it?
Like 20 tries.
I mean, that's a lot of thought into yogurt.
Yeah. I mean, every night we would cook it in, like put it in a dehydrator or a water bath. We would, you know, you have to like basically temper cultured yogurt into some milk and then you have to leave it at different temperatures for different amounts of time. And I think we have it. I think it's really nice. It's like a nice, smooth, clean surface. It's not broken or anything. And then we make we have these really great dried cherries that we incorporate into like a granola with pistachio. Like it's, again, like we're not reinventing it, but it's a great, like everything about the granola is like really well sourced. The milk and the yogurt is really well sourced and it's just simple, but it's well executed.
And you reimagined the carrot dish for,
right,
for brunch. How did you take something that's so beloved and so idea, so well known and give it so its own identity so it doesn't feel like you're eating a lesser version of the dinner because you just got in for brunch because dinner's already booked out for 9 million months.
No, it's not like that. But, like, again, it's like it's about having purpose without it having to be the reason why you're coming there. Like, I want us to be a, you know, hyper-sustainable, thoughtful, good-to-their-employees restaurant, but I don't want any of that to be why someone is eating at the restaurant. And so for us, like we juice a lot of carrots at the restaurant because it takes a lot of, to make the sauce and the crepes. It's a lot of carrot juice, so you know we tried using the pulp, you know, a couple times and we didn't really love it, and we have this great falafel dish recipe that we use for the springtime. We do like a beef falafel, so we just took red lentils, soaked them with the whey from the ricotta making process. That's how we rehydrate the lentils. And we just decided, like, let's just commit to this Dan Barber wasted idea. Well, like, let's just make a dish that is essentially the byproduct of the dinner menu. And let's go one step further. Let's let that be the carrot dish, you know, 2.0. So it's a lot of it. Most of it is, you know, byproduct of just making the carrot dish. It's we put the sunflower sprouts on the carrot dish, so then we have the stem. It's 2 inches long. We needed a crunchy element for our little kati roll that we do, so we use that. We chiffonade a radicchio for a dish at night. There's the end pieces, so we just cut those even smaller, and made a little salad mix with the end pieces of the romaine and radicchio and the sprout stems. And then we have like trim from beets and radishes and red onions, so we just made like a little house chopped pickle mix that we fold in there. And the whole dish is just that. It's just a lot of these random odds and ends that we turned into something else. And now it's sort of just like a big bright orange burrito. But it has like a carrot pulp falafel and the salad from like all this byproduct. and then we use last week's yogurt that we don't sell for brunch to make the raita that we use. We have cilantro on a different dish, so we use the stems from the cilantro and fold that in. And it turned out pretty good.
And that is how you do Olmsted brunch.
Yeah.
Chef, thank you.
You overthink it like
you
crazy.
You overthink it, and then it looks super simple and really pretty on Instagram. Chef, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Where can people find you? What days are brunch?
We are 7-day-a-week restaurant. Dinner, brunch, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and I live across the street, so I'm there
Friday
all the
time. Friday brunch.
Yeah.
Strong.
Yeah.
I like that.
It helps with the scheduling. It helps with a lot of things because now we have 10 services, so now we can have two teams. It helps make everyone's days off more consistent.
Everyone, please go support a Friday brunch. We're going to need the community to turn out. Well, thank you for coming by.
Thank you.
Everyone, check out Olmsted. Next up, we have Snacky Tunes Fives, another addition from our favorite wine enthusiast, Jameson Fink. And then we have Desert Sharks live in studio. Sit back, listen to the sweet, sweet voice of Jameson here on Snacky Tunes.
Yeah. Hi, it's Jameson Fink, and I want to talk a little bit about restaurant wine lists. I was recently at this place on the Upper West Side called Nice Matan, and the wine list there is this big, thick, leather-bound, tome, it might be the word for it. It's pretty big. It has, like, a thwack when you, like, lay it down on the bar. It's sort of intimidating, and it's the kind of list where it can work against me in two ways. One, because if I'm not alone and I'm with someone, I'm going to get lost in it for a really long time, and I might not be back for, like, a half hour. So I wouldn't go there if you were me. I'd say a first date or with anyone you care about, really. Just go there by yourself and nerd out on it. And also, it just also, if I wasn't some, you know, wine expert type dude, I'd be like, I don't even know where to begin. I don't know where to start. I don't know where to end. I don't know anything about French wine. I got to get out of here. I got to go somewhere and get a beer. So what I just did was I flipped through. You know, there's lots of sections, you know, Burgundy, Bordeaux, all that. I went to the section called Other White Wines, which is kind of a hodgepodge of like 10 or 15 wines. It's mostly a French wine place that kind of just don't really fit into one of those categories. And I think that's a great tip, is just to go to like the Other Red or Other White if there's a section, because it's going to be where all kind of the oddball esoteric stuff is that you can kind of geek out on. And it's only like 10 or 15 wines. It's totally manageable, and you probably discover something pretty cool. And I did. I found a Australian Riesling, dry Riesling, pretty much. I haven't had a sweet Riesling from Australia. I'm sure they're out there, but the top quality ones are really dry and they're amazing. And it was a Grosset, who's an incredible producer, and it's their iconic wine, the Polish Hill Riesling. And it was 2010 vintage, and it's a wine that can age beautifully. So that's a bonus too. And it was like $81, which isn't cheap, but for wine in a restaurant, to get a vintage bottle, 2010 vintage, 8 years old, from an iconic producer, iconic site, is pretty amazing. The other thing I thought that was really interesting is that it didn't come ice cold. It came, you know, kind of cellar temperature, I don't know, like 60-something degrees. And it was really good right away. And I think it's like drinking cheap beer. Like, you want cheap beer, like, to be, you know, almost freezing cold so you don't taste how bad it is and you just crush it and chug it. Wine's a lot like that too. Like, you know, your shitty cheap wines, you want to drink them at like an Arctic temperature, because otherwise they're kind of intolerable. But, and then I was also thinking, well, what if I said Australian Riesling and someone misheard me and thought I said Austrian Riesling? I'd go, haha, it doesn't matter, because Austrian Rieslings are also totally awesome, really good, mostly going to be super dry, very refreshing. Both wines are great with seafood, maybe seafood with a little spritz of citrus, a little squeeze of lime on it, fish tacos would be great. They're both really fantastic wines. And also the... you know, we had a bottle, and one of the things I always read about buying wine at restaurants is like, oh, glass pours are a ripoff. You should always get a bottle. That's where the best deals are. But you know what? So what? I don't feel like you're getting ripped off, because if you want to drink, you know, two $15 glasses of wine and you don't want to get a $50 bottle, well, then it's not a ripoff. You just save yourself $20. And also, if you're not going to sit down and be like, I'm going to order a bottle of wine by myself and I'm going to drink it all over the course of a couple hours, or if you're not with a friend who wants to drink that, or your friend's a Zinfandel drinker and you like Pinot Grigio, there's nothing wrong with buying wines by the glass. And also, as long as they rotate them a lot and they're fresh, and any decent place is going to let you taste it beforehand too. They're not going to be like, here it is, you bought it. If you touch it, it's sold. You can't return it. So any good place will give you a little sip, a little taste. And if you don't like it, be like, I don't like it. Bring me something else. I mean, don't be a jerk about it. But, you know, speak your mind. Feel free to stand up for what you think is delicious and tasty, and don't take any shit from anyone. So anyway, that's my little spiel about restaurant wines. I definitely think you should look for those oddball wines and grapes. Look for that other section, even though it's kind of a dumping ground for some things. It's going to be a dumping ground for something that's really cool and of great value and of great interest. Thanks. And you can read, actually, I'll drop a few wine picks for Australian and Austrian Rieslings in my blog at jamesonfink.com. I thought up that name myself. And so I'll publish that, and I'll give you some tips on wines like that and more. Thanks.
100 Bogart Street is finally open and ready for Bushwick.
100 Bogart is a brand new, state-of-the-art co-working space that provides turnkey workspaces, including open layout desks, meeting spaces, and furnished private offices. Members have access to top-notch amenities such as custom furniture, high-speed internet, spacious kitchenettes with coffee and tea, printers, scanners, and much more. Alongside their professional work environment, 100 Bogart also provides exclusive educational programming for any curious entrepreneur. Heritage Radio Network has made their new office home at 100 Bogart and will host many events there in the future. For more information about their co-working space, visit 100bogart.com and become a member to network, create, and educate.
Welcome back to Snacky Tunes. Hello, Desert Sharks. How are you?
Hello.
Hi. We're good.
You said that you met through Craigslist personal ads.
Yes.
Which just went away.
It did? Week.
It
yeah,
did. Because of sex trafficking.
Sex trafficking laws.
Oh,
yes.
No.
So if we were to go and find your personal ads and how you met, what were each of your personal ads?
Wait, Sunny, were you the original personal
ad?
I
think so.
Go ahead. Tell us what you said.
Looking for a relationship or
no,
music.
No, you did not.
Not quite.
What year was this?
I don't know.
2011
or 12.
Rebecca knows.
Well, she's got a memory like a
Well, actually, Rebecca
hawk.
Had the first one.
Doesn't matter. Basically, when I saw, it was your ad.
Who is I?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Stephanie.
Hi, Stephanie.
I play bass and sing in Desert Sharks. I saw Rebecca's ad.
Did I see
your ad?
You saw my ad.
I saw Sunny's ad that was like, I'm into Sleater-Kinney and
Typo Negative.
It was a mix of the most random shit. It was like Sleater-Kinney and Typo Negative and Pat Benatar
and gosh, I don't know what else you said.
Susie and the Banshees.
It was a bunch of random stuff, but it was a lot of female bands.
So. And you're like, oh, okay, this works.
Yeah, because I just moved here and I was like, I'm bored. I want to play with other people, and I'd never played with other women before, so I saw her ad and I responded.
And were the rest of you all Craigslist, or was it just that? And then
all of us.
So Rebecca had to add up that she was looking to join a band that was already established. And I was like, would you want to start something new? She's like, okay.
Oh. We forced. Yeah. Me, Sunny, and Rebecca. Rebecca plays drums. Sunny's lead guitar. And we all met at a Starbucks one awkward day. And we were like,
oh, yeah. I had met Sunny before that. It was just the two of us.
Yeah.
And how hard was it? Why did you want to join something established as opposed to something new?
I honestly don't even remember saying that. I think I was just looking for anything. I just wanted to play some music in a band.
I mean, this is like 2012, so this is like before people would, you know, really before, maybe OK Cupid was at that time. But
ooh,
it's like,
yeah.
So it's like, you know, there's it's still maybe not like.
Maybe Nerve. Nerve.com.
Oh,
what
yeah.
the heck is Nerve?
I've never heard of that.
I don't know what that is.
Grandma over here with her Nerve.
So was the first meeting just along ones like, hey, did you immediately recognize each other? Had you exchanged photos, or were you just looking for women in all black?
I had no idea. Well, Rebecca, I met Rebecca first, and she sent me a link to her old band, so I knew what she looked like, but she had no idea
I
who
did
I
not
was.
Know what Sunny looked like
I didn't
at
know
all.
What either of you looked like. I sent you links to my old bands, too.
Yeah.
It just happened by, you know, the universe aligning that we all kind of look like each other. And then we had a different second guitar player for a little, like, for like 2 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And she didn't like us.
Yeah, we never played any shows with her. That was before we actually were
she
established.
She bailed. She was like, this sucks, I'm out.
She's like, no, not interested.
Yeah.
And then from there, did you use Craigslist for anything else?
We used Craigslist to find her.
So I Stefania. Posted an ad and I was like, my band broke up and I'd like to play in a band again. And they were the first people that reached out to me, and I auditioned, and then they were like, okay, see you around.
We didn't know what to say.
First off, how long were you a band before you made her?
Like a month.
That's so cold. That's.
I didn't know. I didn't know them very well, and everybody was really shy and quiet, and I was like, okay, we'll talk to you soon. But I didn't know if they liked them, so I didn't want to be like, you're in.
Yeah, we wanted to wait to talk to each other before we knew if we liked Stefania.
Well, you made me feel bad.
And I guess we liked
her. We're just so awkward, so we're like, see you around.
Bye. We've been a band for a month. See you later.
Bye. Maybe you'll make the cut.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, there's a lot of other Craigslist ads we have to comb through. So what do you think, what's going to replace this? Like, how are you going to, like, not saying you would break
bands
up.
Bands of the future?
Yeah, how are they going to find each other?
They're going to just like put in a contact lens and like touch a button on their arm and be like, who wants to jam? And it'll pop up. No, I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. Because if I think about if I lived in a different city, I don't even know where I would begin.
MySpace.
MySpace.com.
I wonder if you can make Spotify should do this. Because they should just make make a playlist and be like, I want to form a band, and then maybe they can match playlists.
Oh my god. You should talk to Spotify and make $1 million.
Dear Spotify.
Don't tell anybody.
No.
Nobody listen to this part.
Yeah, no. Well, no one's listening anyway, so it's fine. Can we hear a song?
Yes.
What are you going to play for us first?
This song is called Don't Be Shy, Alicia, which will be coming on a new album, hopefully this year.
Definitely
we're working on it. Definitely this year. Working on it.
Here we are. Desert Sharks Live.
I saw online that some, but not all of you, were on Gotham as a band.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know Gotham, it is the prequel to how Batman
became. Yeah, it's like baby Batman.
Like baby Batman. How did that come about, and what was the role of the house band? Or what was the band on Gotham?
What was it called? The Sirens?
It was the house band for the Sirens Club, which was owned by a couple of the female characters, I believe.
The bad boys. Right. Bad girls.
Tabitha and Barbara.
Tabitha and Barbara.
That is correct.
Basically, a friend of ours reached out to us and said, hey, I saw that Gotham is looking for a house band, and they're looking for women. And they reached out to the band, and how did we submit? Yeah.
Well, he tagged us on Facebook on a post looking for a band. Yeah, and then we sent an email to, I guess, the casting agency saying we saw this post, and they responded and are like, yeah, you got it. We like you.
Yeah, it was weird.
Was it multiple episodes or for just one?
Multiple.
Several. Multiple episodes. Yeah, did you have to?
4 or 5.
And what's the, is it original music or did they write it for you? Or
no,
how does it work?
It's like covers. It's like covers of like 80s jams,
right? The
first
song was I Know What Boys Like by The Waitresses.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But it's like their own in-house band. And then everybody's just pretending to play. So like they're like, we want real musicians. But then you play and you're not really playing.
Right. But I couldn't actually hit the drums.
But so who recorded the song? What did you record it?
No.
Like studio musicians. Like
studio musicians.
Yeah, they would just send us a recording and be like, listen to this, know how to play this. And then we just come in and pretend.
They wanted real musicians to pretend.
Real musicians to pretend.
Yeah.
They wanted it to look real.
To look real. Oh, so they didn't want to be like, so you're just like, oh yeah, I know how to play the drums. And like, you're just hitting the snare.
They wouldn't let her hit the drums for like most of the scenes. And then one scene, they'd let her hit the drums.
When it was a close-up of us, I could hit it. But then otherwise, I had to be silent because there was dialogue going on with the other actors. So, yeah.
So it was really cool.
Did you have any input on the songs or any of the direction? Or, or any of that? They're just like, you just looked, you were...
Well, what's weird is like every single song had a totally different singer. So we were in like 5 episodes, but... the voice would change from like super high to super low. Like there was a Grace Jones cover that was like a man singing and it was a woman like mimicking. So
you were just the backing band.
Yeah.
We were just the back. And just, like,
no, but it was always the same singer, but her voice just kept changing.
The voice was changing. And then it was like, they'd have you there at the studio for like, I was only in 1 episode. So I'm Stephanie again, the bass player, singer lady. But, like, I didn't have the free time to be the actual singer, so I just played the bass player in 1 episode. And we were there for, like, 11 hours for literally 2 seconds of a clip.
Oh, that was a short one.
Yeah, it was a short clip. But, hey, whatever. It was fun.
Can we hear another song?
Oh, yeah.
Real, but this time play it. Okay, this is a Grace
Jones. This is real. I'm not Grace Jones.
It's a Grace Jones cover.
Seasick. Jesus. Not seasick Jesus, just Jesus, seasick. Jesus. Yeah, they're ready.
I'm not afraid to die.
one of... Hello, hello, hello.
Yes,
can you hear me?
Woo! Check, check, microphone.
One of the cool things is that you're on the Bad Cramps comp.
Oh, yeah.
We had Harsh Crowd in a couple years ago, who was graduates now of Willie Mae's Rock Camp for Girls. How did, are you graduates?
Sonny used to teach it.
Oh, really? Willie did you teach there?
I was just like the band coach. So they would put all the girls together in a room and like they would just form bands and none of them knew each other. And it'd be like, we'll guide them. Like, I don't know what the fuck to do. So it's just like play stuff and it sounds good. And it was just interesting to see their dynamic as kids.
How do you encourage kids to be in a band? Like, I mean, what is the advice you give them when, you know, it's 8 to 8. For those who don't know, it's all girls and then some young women. It's 8 to 18, which is obviously a wide range. What advice do you give the same advice to the 8-year-olds, the 18-year-olds, or when they're forming bands, like, what do you tell them?
Kind of, I think just women in general, when they go to play and they're not experienced, they're insecure, and they're like, well, I don't want to play this, or I don't want to sing, it sounds bad. So you just have to encourage them to be like, no, it doesn't sound bad, just keep doing it.
Yeah.
You have to be willing to suck in order to get better.
But what if your kid is a drummer, and it's super loud?
What?
You moved into the basement.
You just have to deal with it. My parents did.
Yeah. Who else was on the comp? And you also did a benefit show
Basic
for it as well.
Basic Bitches.
Mm-hmm. Tanya Harding.
Tanya Harding. Who else was on that?
Tim Bulba.
Sonny knows all the names.
This was a while ago. I don't remember.
Yeah. It was cool, though.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Didn't Naomi organize it?
Yeah.
Yeah, she organized it.
Naomi from Basic Bitches organized it, and she's awesome.
And you're also...
Shout out.
...working on an upcoming record.
Yes, we're working on our first full length. It's time.
It's time.
It's time!
It's been something, but you've put out other like DIY projects and EPs and demos and things like
We've
that.
We've done 3 sort of EPs at this point. One of them was self-released. One of them was with Converse Rubber Tracks.
And love then one, Rubber Tracks.
Which was awesome. I'm so depressed that they're gone.
I know.
Oh, they're gone.
It was such a good...
Such a good thing, such a cool opportunity to get, because recording can be really expensive. And then the third one, the last EP we did in 2014 was with Manimal. So it's time, we're overdue, and we've been working for a long time writing our first full length. So,
and what goes into a full length in 2018?
Stress, anxiety, worrying about the world exploding.
Before you get the record out.
Yeah.
Please don't, world don't catch on fire before Desert Shark puts out their first LP.
Please, let us survive. Yeah. I mean, it's like a collective of a few different years of stuff we've been writing. So like there's some tracks on there that are actually like,
what is a song we haven't played in, like, 2 years? And
what is
it's going to be on there?
No, it's not called that. It's called For Loneliness Sake.
It was one of the first songs we ever wrote as a band. We've just been waiting for the full length to put it out.
Yeah, but who knows if we'll still play it, but...
Just to have it out there. I mean, it's not like everyone puts out a record and they play every song on there.
Yeah, we're just kind of like, let's just know hesitations, expectations. Let's just do whatever. Let's put it out there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we want to make sure we have time for one more song, but where can people find your early EPs and demos and upcoming shows?
All of our music is on Spotify and iTunes, but you can also follow us on Facebook and Instagram.
Bandcamp.
At Desert Sharks.
And MySpace.
And we don't... Do we have a MySpace?
And we have an AOL profile.
We're on Friendster.
And R.I.P. Craig's...
R.P. Craigslist! I don't know how you're going to start your band
Well, we've got that Spotify idea.
That's true.
We'll share
I think that you need to...
We'll do it together.
We'll do it together!
You'll be the face of it.
Oh my God.
We want to thank Chef Backstrom for coming in, Jameson Fink, and Desert Sharks. If you like this episode, please make sure to subscribe to Snacky Tunes. Leave us a review, give us 5 stars, and I would also say head to the archives and you can listen to other episodes, including the one with Harsh Crowd. Who are great. What's the name of the song you're going to take us out with?
The song is called I Don't Know How to Dress for the Apocalypse.
Who does?
Nobody does.
But I hope the apocalypse doesn't come before your LP comes out.
We've got 5 years and we'll be okay. You know, just to get everything out there.
Yeah. You think it's going to take 5 years to do the LP?
No, 5 years for the apocalypse.
Oh, okay. And then the LP, then maybe you have a second LP.
We'll be like, check this out.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks for listening. We'll be back with another... episode of Snacky Tunes. Take it away. It's
about food. We talk about music with musical dudes. Finger on the pulse, Snacky Tunes.
Thanks for listening to Heritage Radio Network, food radio supported by you. For our freshest content and to hear about exclusive events, subscribe to our newsletter. Enter your email at the bottom of our website, heritageradionetwork.org. Connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at @heritage_radio. Heritage Radio Network is a nonprofit organization driving conversations to make the world a better, fairer, more delicious place. And we couldn't do it without support from listeners like you. Want to be a part of the food world's most innovative community? Rate the shows you like, tell your friends, and please join our community by becoming a member. Just click on the beating heart at the top right of our homepage. Thanks for listening.